What are you thinking about when you're on these challenges?
Do you know what? Like, that's what's strange in that I think every single tide and every single day you can use something different. It's almost like, you know, changing the channel on your head, you know, that you've got to find a new, something that's quite potent, you know, some thought that's going to take you away and you can just think about it. Again, you guys know, you know, sparring, running, anything where you're just in that hurt locker. But I think what was interesting for me is sometimes if you look at Maslow's hierarchy of needs, so Maslow's hierarchy, this idea of a pyramid, and at the base of that pyramid, you've got your physiological needs. So food, water, warmth, sleep, you know, you're basically like a caveman there at the base. As you move up, you've got your social needs. So you've got kind of like friends, family, connections. As you move up even further, you've got prestige, a feeling of accomplishment, you know, job security. And then as you move up at the very top, you've got self-actualization, which is this idea of being like the best version of you. And for me, it was weird because I would like basically go up and down this all the time in that sometimes, you know, you could say to me, oh, Ross, self-actualization, you know, this is amazing, you know, intrinsic motivation. And I'll be like, yes, that's amazing. But other times I'm sitting there, my tongue's falling off. And I'm like, I literally don't care about like any of those higher purposes. I'm here. I'm at the base of the pyramid. I'm thinking I want to sleep. I want food and I want to still have a tongue when this finishes. Like, I'm there.
Did you live in that spot the whole time? Because I've never obviously done anything at the same level as you, but as an endurance athlete in cycling, I've always found that time that you spend in that exercise can actually be really fluid for your mind. And you actually have great, there's been so many times where I've been on the bike at mile 60, mile 70, mile 80, where I'm like, I have to pull over and write this down right now. Did you ever get those blasts of ideation or concept and you're like, yo, I need to tell somebody this right now?
100%. And I think we've lost that a little bit. Like Plato talks about it. You know, Plato, although he influenced Western philosophy as we know it today, Plato, his name, that was his nickname. It meant broad shoulders. He was a great wrestler. And I think we've lost that like, I love what you just said there, because it's this idea of being a scholar athlete. And I forget who said this now, and I'm going to kind of butcher this quote. It wasn't Plato, but they said, the problem with society is that too often, if you have your fighting done by soldiers and your thinking done by politicians, you have your fighting done by idiots and your thinking done by cowards. Mm. You know, it was this idea, you need to fuse the two. Right. You need to be a scholar athlete. You know, and that was one thing that I think I found, that I did some of my best writing around Great Britain. I was left alone with my own thoughts for 12 hours a day.
That's powerful.
It's so powerful. Like, yeah.
I think people highly underestimate the power of their own minds. Like maybe people are fearful of how strong their mental capacity truly is. Like, what's that one quote? Our greatest fear is not that we are inadequate. It's that we're powerful beyond measure. And I've been trying to find more time to be alone and sit and rest with my thoughts. Cause agree. Like there's so much that goes on in your own brain and you can pull so much just out of you. And once you do that and you're on like the fourth rung of the hierarchy of needs and self-actualization, I think that's a crucial part of discovering out who you are and who the best version of yourself is.
100%. And it goes to some weird places. I mean, also to come back to that question, what I thought about sometimes when swimming, I think what would get weird is I actually, not sound morbid, but I started to research prisoners of war and how they were coping. And there was this one mechanism, it was called the Stockdale Paradox. Admiral Stockdale basically was a prisoner of war for 7 years in Vietnam, tortured, horrific conditions, but never gave up any intel or anything. And afterwards, when they said, like, how did you survive? Like, everyone else was crumbling around you, but you remained so stoic and strong. How did you do it? And he just said, you know what? He could see the people coming in who would crumble. He would point at them, go, he's not going to make it. And they said, why? And he said, because it's this kind of dual thought process. He said, you cannot lose sight of hope. Like, you will be out. This will be over. It will finish. But equally, at the same time, you have to face up to your current reality. And it's this dual approach that, you know, everybody listening can experience it. If you're running, you got to think, okay, this will be over. Your legs will stop hurting at some point. The same when I was swimming, I was up Margate, which is where my finish was. Yep. It will finish and I will eventually swim around Great Britain. There's hope. But equally, my current reality is, you know, I've got a jellyfish on my face, you know, and I've got to face up to that.
Yeah, yeah.
And too often, and this is what Stockdale said, he said you had these optimists who just came in, they were like, we'll be out by Christmas. Christmas would come, Christmas would go, they'd be crushed. We'll be out by Easter. You know, it's going to be over. The war's going to be over. Gone. And they'd slowly break down, whereas Stockdale was just like, hey, look, as long as this takes, I'm here. It will be over, but I'm also in my current reality. And so that's one thing as well that I mean, my girlfriend's amazing. I've been with her 7 years, and she basically saw her boyfriend. She would come on every sort of few weeks and just see me getting hairier, like fatter. I was like, you know, I couldn't stop as well when I was swimming. So I was just going to the toilet in my wetsuit. So I was just, you know, I smelled, piss. I just pissed myself.
Bro, I have a picture of you after your 1 year at sea.
Oh my God.
Damn.
A weathered man.
You look like a salt field.
I mean, I look like a chubby Santa Claus, like at sea. Like a salty Santa Claus. But you see what I mean now. So my girlfriend saw me now, and then, you know, that was what I finished with.
She's like, who is this guy? Ross?
Exactly. Odysseus.
This is exactly it. Smelling of urine as well. That was how I rocked out of the sea. So you think about these things of, like, you know, you have these epiphanies and these romantic ideals. But no, that was my current reality. And I love how we've talked about this idea of, like, sometimes it's not a romantic ideal swimming around. But no, like, it's suffering. It's eudaimonia. That's what eudaimonia looks like, as scary as it is to look at.
My two, and again, not to compare, but my two things that I go to when I'm trying to escape, maybe escape isn't the right word, but forego the reality of whatever shitstorm I'm going through, is I'll really try to separate my mind from my body. Whether it's, you know, a 10-minute ice bath, whether it's the 4 hours of boxing training, the 10-mile jogs, I try to visualize why I'm doing it. Did you ever do that? Like when I'm running on the treadmill, when I'm running on a track and it's pitch black, the lights are off, and it's me and Mac, and the only ones are on the track on like a Friday night. I go, why am I doing this? And I kept picturing my hand getting raised in the boxing match, my hand getting raised and my opponent crumpling to the floor and all my dreams coming true. And none of them did.
I argue with that. I think they did though. I think you got from, I think you got from the whole boxing thing that what you wanted. I think with retrospect, you've looked at it now. It's been great to see your journey, but I think you got everything you wanted,
for
regardless
sure.
of the outcome.
For sure.
And that's what I think is important.